I don't need to be a cybersecurity expert. Having a company like CrowdStrike, knowing that we're protected.
CrowdStrike was the world's largest and most respected IT security provider.
CrowdStrike is embedded within your organization. They understand the deployment and they're watching your back.
One tiny update made them the culprits of the worst IT disaster in history.
Tonight, in the grips of an unprecedented computer shutdown,
this crash was historic.
To which a single software glitch could have such widespread impact.
This is how one software update brought down 8.5 million computers, taking down planes, banks, hospitals, governments, and half the world with it. It all began early in the morning. On July 19th, 2024, at 4 a.m. UTC, members of the CrowdStrike team are preparing to roll out a new update to their flagship product, CrowdStrike Falcon Sensor. This product monitors activity on a computer and looks for any threats that might appear in real time, malware, ransomware, and other cyber attacks. Though calling it an update might be an overstatement, it was just some new information for the tool to identify the latest malicious software, a routine activity the team performed several times every day. At 4:09 a.m., the information was deployed and the CrowdStrike team called it a day. PCs with Falcon product sensors around the world began downloading the new information. Everything continued as normal, at least for the first few minutes, but soon the team started to notice issues. Windows PCs that received the update abruptly experienced the dreaded blue screen of death, and it wasn't just one or two cases either, it was all of them. These PCs tried to boot three times before Windows forced them into recovery mode to prevent further damage, and it didn't take a team of professionals to realize that something was very wrong. At 5:27 a.m., the team halted their rollout and immediately deployed a fix, but the damage had already been done. The whole world was about to experience the worst IT disaster in history. Around this time, workers in Asia and Australia are in the later part of their day, but as they finish work, they notice something. Cafes and retail workers notice their sales systems have suddenly stopped working. When investigating further, they see that their inventory management is also having trouble. New orders can't be loaded or tracked, and many businesses are unable to serve customers, but this was just the beginning. Office workers see their computers suddenly experience the blue screen of death. They watch helplessly as Windows attempts to restart multiple times before booting into a recovery mode, prompting users to enter a BitLocker recovery key. This key is just a code to manually decrypt the data on the hard drive and recover the machine. For most, finding this key or working around it was simply an annoyance, but not everyone had the luxury of time. You see, it wasn't just Windows computers that were affected, but also Windows servers and Windows-based infrastructure. And businesses started noticing that everything had completely stopped functioning at the exact same time. They soon realized that it's not just their company either. At 6 a.m. on the other side of the globe, people in Europe are beginning their days and discover the same issues as the rest of the world. They can't start their workdays because their office equipment won't start. While this was a major problem, it was nothing compared to what was happening elsewhere. At 7 a.m, various US states, including Arizona and Alaska, watched their 911 services suddenly go offline. There is now no way for these citizens to call for help, and emergency response workers scrambled to fix the issue, but in the confusion, they can't find any solution. Some assume it's a Windows update, others think it's a local issue, but no one is quite sure. Simultaneously, hospitals like Penn Medicine in Pennsylvania and Northwell Health in New York experienced crashes in their computer systems. Staff immediately delayed non-urgent visits, even including some surgeries and physical injuries. As they tried to assess and fix their system, the backlog of patients and surgeries continues to grow. With every passing minute, the world begins to realize just how reliant we have become on tech. At 8 a.m, the Federal Aviation Administration identifies a similar issue. Flight navigation is failing to function as it should. Given that most flights are automated with computers, this is a huge problem. They immediately ordered every flight from Delta, American Airlines, United, and Allegiant Airlines to all be grounded regardless of destination. Over 5,000 flights are grounded and 35,000 flights are delayed as staff tried to resolve the issue.
And a lot of folks telling us that they are confused about what's going on, that they have gotten no official word about a ground stop or any cancellations. I want to show you this crowd.
Over 1 million passengers were left stranded, many of them in airports far from home. It's a similar fate for cargo flights. UPS, FedEx, and other shipping companies see their computer systems go down, and their flights are unable to depart. They issue a statement telling customers that many of their packages will be delayed. It's at this time that CrowdStrike, amidst peak panic, releases a public statement. At 9:45 AM UTC, CEO George Kurtz tweets, "CrowdStrike is actively working with customers impacted by a defect found in a single content update for Windows hosts. Mac and Linux hosts are not impacted. This is not a security incident or cyber attack. The issue has been identified, isolated, and a fix has been deployed." Despite this optimistic statement, there was a major problem. Deploying the fix doesn't solve the issue. All the impacted Windows computers must be fixed manually. Someone needed to delete the faulty file from the directory either in person or remotely. And it's not like they needed to manually fix a few computers. At this point, there are over 8 million of them. CrowdStrike was in full damage control mode, and the damage was still spreading. Between 10 and 11 a.m., public transport in the northeast of the United States crawls to a halt. Trains and buses suddenly can't depart. Passengers are forced to wait with no idea when things will resume. By 12 p.m., many global and regional banks experience outages. Their customer portals completely stop functioning. Simultaneously, most of the computers in the U.S. federal government become unusable, and they begin an investigation working directly with CrowdStrike to resolve the ongoing crisis. IT support workers from all kinds of organizations work around the clock to get these machines up and running, and we finally see a glimmer of hope. At 2 p.m., some flights begin to resume with extreme caution. Some companies have their computers back online and business is able to resume, but for many others, the issues continue. At 4 p.m., federal agencies are still trying to fix the issues, while hospitals still report outages. It's at this point that President Biden is briefed on the crisis, and CrowdStrike CEO issues another statement. "I want to sincerely apologize directly to all of you for today's outage. All of CrowdStrike understands the gravity and impact of the situation. We have mobilized all of CrowdStrike to help you and your teams. If you have questions or need additional support, please reach out to your CrowdStrike representative or technical support." They also release a full report of the event, which includes help from those attempting to repair their systems. Much of the world was back online within a day, but massive issues still lingered given that each device had to be manually fixed. Less than 1% of all Windows machines were affected, but these weren't just any devices. These were at the heart of banks, airlines, hospitals, governments, and more. So even at only 1%, the impact was massive. In fact, it's estimated that Fortune 500 companies experienced close to a $5.4 billion financial loss. This event was a disaster, and it was all because of one new piece of information. So how did this all happen? How did one update impact the IT world so greatly and so quickly? Well, it comes down to how CrowdStrike works. CrowdStrike's Falcon Sensor is not just any antivirus software, it's the ultimate antivirus software. Think of the product as the immune system. It does a fantastic job of looking for threats and can automatically neutralize them. But when it malfunctions, it can cause terrible consequences. CrowdStrike's Falcon Sensor is very similar. It operates at the lowest possible level of your computer, not just amongst user software, but in the kernel, the essential program that runs your operating system and talks to hardware. This means that Falcon Sensor can see everything at the lowest level of monitoring, so it's highly secure and the best line of defense. But that comes with downsides and risks as well. If something goes wrong with regular user software, the program crashes. But if something goes wrong in the kernel program, the whole device crashes. And this is exactly what happened. CrowdStrike didn't release a major update. It was the smallest piece of new information to help identify new malicious software. But it was faulty information that created a logic error. This itself didn't cause Windows to crash, but it did cause stability issues. And when Windows noticed this, it immediately crashed the computer to prevent any further damage. The blue screen of death was actually Windows protecting computers from the alternative. But how did this bad information get rolled out if the stakes are so high? Well, CrowdStrike carries out automated checks for these new updates, which is called a content validator. This can only go so far in identifying bugs, but given that CrowdStrike had rolled out thousands of such updates in the past, they didn't feel that anything more was necessary. CrowdStrike says, due to baseline trust from previous tests and successful deployments, no additional testing like dynamic checks was performed. So the bad update reached clients, causing the massive global IT outage. If they tested this manually on any Windows PC, they probably would have noticed the issue. It's apparent that the company dropped the ball, publishing the update without thorough testing. With that being said though, with how much code companies like CrowdStrike deploy, some bad code will likely make it through no matter how much testing they have. And that brings us to why cybersecurity experts are really furious at CrowdStrike. They're not furious because CrowdStrike developed some faulty code, but because of how they deployed the faulty code. You see, virtually all modern tech infrastructure uses something called staging to protect itself from exactly this, bad updates. It's essentially when you slowly roll out an update phase by phase, instead of updating everyone at the exact same time. Half of more of the computers purposely stay an update or two behind. This way, even if a new update causes a disaster, the computers that weren't updated will continue working as expected. So why did Fortune 500 companies, airlines, and emergency services not have this in place? Well, they did. CrowdStrike simply bypassed it. Keep in mind, their product is at the kernel level, and they just assumed that automated checks were enough. So they rolled out the new information to everyone immediately. CS caused untold millions, and really billions of dollars in damages, not just because they pushed a bad update, but because they pushed an update that ignored their customer staging policies, which would have prevented this type of widespread damage. Unbelievable. CrowdStrike has shown just how fragile the world's IT systems can be. Many systems are just one dependency away from causing a chain reaction, but this disaster, with all its damage, will hopefully make IT stronger as a result. It has shown everyone firsthand the weaknesses, just like the pandemic did for the world's supply chains. The issue comes from the lack of redundancies or the ignorance of them, like having offline systems, staging, multiple operating systems, or third-party products. The companies that did have redundancies were impacted but quickly resolved. Those that didn't went down altogether. With rate cuts around the corner, if you would like to lock in high yields for the long term, consider checking out our platform Silo in the description below. We're the modern bond platform that only charges $1 per bond. Also, we're currently running a 3% deposit bonus. If that sounds interesting, click the link below. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.